is how I get.
Hello, welcome back to the Great Hall of Leeds University. She's Catherine Stott, I'm Petroc Trelawney. Welcome to the very last semi-final of this 2021 Leeds International Piano Competition.
What a great night this is going to be, and the real culmination of the semi-final rounds. We're going to hear two more exciting pianists tonight, so stay with us.
Yes, we've got Dmitry Chony from Ukraine and Alim Besenbaev from Kazakhstan. Musically, over the next few hours, Thomas Addis, Schumann, Scriabin, Ligeti, Ravel, and in terms of chamber music, well, we're going to hear a piano quartet, aren't we, by Brahms?
We are, and that's the first piano quartet we've heard so far, but we're also going to hear the wonderful sonata by César Franck.
Yeah, which is a glorious piece of music that we both love. I'm sure you do too. If you don't know it, stay with us to watch that. What will happen after we've heard our two pianists this evening is that our jury will retreat to their room backstage here at the Great Hall of Leeds University and contemplate. They'll add up their marks and we'll come up with the names of five finalists. So we'll go forward to Friday and Saturday night's grand final in Leeds Town Hall when they'll play a concerto with the Royal Liverpool Philharmonic Orchestra. It could be one of two concertos because each pianist has had to come up with a pair.
Exactly, and at this point, obviously, they've just been working on both of them and nobody knows what will be chosen. But we'll be able to tell the audience tonight, won't we?
We will, definitely.
What they'll be able to hear.
And make sure you're on Facebook for that because we're going to stream that announcement of the final five, the five finalists, on the medici.tv and the Leeds Piano Facebook page. So make sure you've got access to that. That'll be 45 minutes, probably realistically more like an hour after we hear the last note of music played here in the Great Hall. Now, all over Leeds, I know Cathy's been looking at them today, there are pianos to be played as part of the Leeds Piano Competition piano trail here at the university, in the shopping arcades, out on the streets. There's also a fantastic app to get young people, or indeed people of any age who've never played the piano before, to try striking a few of the keys. Let's have a look.
So my name's Lawrence Owen, and I'm the immersive technology artist for the Leeds Piano Trail, and I developed Impromptunes, which is a series of piano tutorials that you can access at all of the playable pianos across the city centre, and each tutorial teaches you a different basic aspect of improvisational piano. I'm not a musician. When I got hired to make the Impromptunes, I didn't know anything about playing the piano at all. So I had to, I'm not a virtuoso now by any means, but I taught myself a few basic skills and I took notes while I was doing that. And at the beginning I was like, oh no, they should have hired someone who's really good at piano, this is a mistake. And then gradually, as I talked to more professional pianists and improvisational pianists and piano teachers, I realised that actually I'm in a very good position because I'm not at the point where I've forgotten how difficult just sitting at a piano and just playing a couple of keys can be. So to access Impromptunes, all you do is you find a piano, you sit down, and there's a link on the website to Impromptunes. You just tap that and then there's a list of the different locations. You tap the location that you're at, and then a little tutorial comes up, and you just tap through. It's got diagrams of all the different keys that you might need to press. There's sometimes a bit of explanation about the area or an aspect of music theory, but all in very basic, accessible terms. The way I see the partnership between the piano competition and the piano trail is the piano competition is very much a celebration of immense technical skill. And we have some, it's the most talented piano players in the world are here. And then the trail, by comparison, is all about celebrating the piano as a tool of the community. But I think I really wanted to connect with people who feel unwelcome at a piano or who feel anxious or nervous or for whatever reason have never interacted with a piano in their entire lives and who feel daunted by the prospect of even sitting and playing a single key. That's really the people that I wanted to connect with.
It's really a fantastic thing, isn't it?
It's absolutely amazing. I'm really fascinated now to hear more about it.
Yeah, Lawrence is with us, who we saw in that film, who is the designer of the app. And also Inon Barnatan, one of our distinguished Leeds Piano Competition jury. Inon, you had a go in the break between sessions. Did you enjoy it?
I loved it. I love the idea of appealing to people who have not or are not pianists or have not had the chance to interact with the piano, which I think is such an amazing, holistic way of thinking about this whole endeavor by the Leeds competition.
Yeah. Nancy, you were saying you're an improving pianist.
I can do one chord progression and improvise with the other hand, and that's about it. But if I do that in a train station, people love it.
Yeah, I mean, what gave you the idea for this now?
Well, because originally the brief was an augmented reality app, and augmented reality is you sort of hold up your phone and then kind of images appear. You see them on Snapchat filters and stuff. And then when I read more about the piano trail itself, I kind of thought, I don't really think they want augmented reality. I think they want something that centers the piano. And in the past year, I've become very interested in the idea of technology and ethics. There's a very interesting speaker, Tristan Harris, who used to work as an ethics consultant for Apple. He talks about how technology should be a tool to enhance human brilliance. And he does a lot of work about creating things that are designed ethically and which support human endeavors in a way that is not kind of overwhelming us with information. As social media apps are designed in a kind of quite exploitative way. And I wanted to make something that was very minimalist. And I'd still consider it a form of augmented reality, but I think a lot of designers would disagree with me.
Well, I think it's absolutely fascinating. Have you had a really good take-up to it on the trail? What's the interest been so far?
I actually haven't seen the numbers. It's been very strange because so my background is actually in theatrical improvisation, and so I'm used to being in the room with people and guiding people through exercises and stuff, and it's been very odd to write something, and then it kind of... I did test it with a group of about 10 testers who then... I saw videos of people trying out the exercises and I had feedback forms, but it's very odd as a kind of teaching practitioner to write something and then it kind of goes to the ether.
Yeah. We were talking, Cathy and I, earlier on about how technology can be used to help pianists. You know, this is an instrument that's been around for many, many centuries, longer than the computer. I mean, in one way, we're seeing that lots over these few days, a pianist playing from iPads or from other tablets. And I noticed that the jury are using iPads to look at the music. Do you use them to play?
I was one of the first ones to use an iPad to play, and I haven't played with an actual score for many years. I absolutely love it. Once you get used to it, it's hard to start carrying all this bags and bags of music again.
And you were saying, Cathy, as a teaching device, it's fantastic because you can really work through scores. You can note, you can save different versions.
Exactly. And you can follow, you can draw on it, you can use colours, and you can have all your scores downloaded. And I'm somebody that uses scores in performance, but I'm not very good with a pedal yet. So I'm still got to master that. I thought it might be my lockdown project, but I failed miserably. So work in progress for me still.
You kind of admitted you have a terror of the pedal.
Do you have to give away my secrets?
But I'm just wondering, you might be able to help here with advice on how to get over the terror of the pedal.
Private lessons, maybe.
You should share it with us on medici.tv.
Just makes perfect. Yeah.
No, I think because I have to move my when I play, my left foot is over the soft pedal, the una corda. And to move to the left, for me, somehow shifts all my balance. So I just need to practice it more, that's all it is.
Makes perfect.
You should talk to a harp player, they have seven pedals.
I know. That's why I play the piano and not the harp.
Lars, another question for you. I mean, this device, as we saw in the film there, is very much designed around the pianos that are here at the Leeds Piano Competition. We've got 500,000 viewers in China for this program. We've got, I think, 110 countries we've reached so far. Is this going to work in other territories?
Yes, actually. So I have been asked to write 5 more exercises that are to be used after the trail is finished, because we have some pianos that are remaining in the city centre. We have one piano that is going on a tour, and so I've written one exercise for that piano, which is about climate change, because also the piano is decorated, and the artist who decorated it, it is on the theme of climate change and of the melting ice caps. And so I was inspired by a very interesting researcher called Judy Tweet, who's a climate scientist, and she does a lot of data sonification, which is basically taking data and making it into sound and music, because she believes that that's a really effective way of cutting through the kind of data overwhelm that we have with the climate crisis. And so I have an exercise where I get people to basically look at a chart, interpret it, and then create a short composition about based on the data of it's a chart that records the the ice mass of the polar ice caps across about 40 years or so. And so there's a you play a chord for every year, and then in between the years you follow the line as it declines downwards.
This is great stuff, Ian, isn't it? I mean, this is the piano touching all our lives.
Incredible. It is, and I think that's something that musicians and non-musicians should really think about more, is about how this is not an isolated thing. Art is always a part of the world around it, and how it interacts with the world. I mean, we sometimes forget, we get so laser focused on what we're doing and forget to actually relate it to everything else. So it's really so commendable that you are, and that the Leeds competition is doing that as well.
Really interesting discussion. Thank you both very much indeed for joining us. Lawrence Owen, who has designed this fantastic app, which is available here in Leeds, and you can find and use. Ian Barnaton, who is one of our distinguished judges, who will now go and join fellow members of the jury, because we're about 2 minutes away, maybe 3 minutes. None of the jury apart from Ian here yet. No, Ryan is over there. Ryan Wigglesworth is here. But we're going to have them in place, ready for our first pianist of the evening, Dmytro Chony from Ukraine. Let's just remind ourselves of his performance in the second round of the competition. Here he is playing Brahms. There's the gorgeous, shining black box of magic that Dmytro Chony will use in just a minute or so's time as he makes his bid for a place in the final of the 2021 Leeds International Piano Competition. A light drizzle outside the Great Hall of the University this evening. As the light gradually fades away, it will be dark in 75 minutes or so, when Dmytro Chony has completed his performance and touched those black and white keys. We're going to hear Schumann's Novelette in F-sharp minor and Scriabin, his piano sonata, number four in the same key of F sharp. We start with his choice of the compulsory contemporary and late 20th century works. He's gone for the three mazurkas of Thomas Addis.
Very popular choice, actually, with the competitors. And I'm looking forward to hearing this Schumann, which is a set of eight pieces. And here he comes onto the platform now.
Dmitry Charlie, 28 years old, from Ukraine, our penultimate semi-finalist here at Leeds.
Thank you. Dmytro Chony, 28 years old, from Ukraine, our penultimate semi-finalist here at the 2021 Leeds International Piano Competition, playing Scriabin, the piano sonata number 4 in F sharp.
Yeah, what a wonderful piece that is. It's so concise. And, you know, you've got that really mystical first movement that doesn't last too long. And I think the challenge for any pianist is, you know, when you're about to pace yourself up to that fantastic finale, the last few pages where everything explodes and Scriabin wanted that to go as fast as the speed of light. How are you actually going to pace that from tiny beginnings? So I think the jury will be looking to see how he managed that journey.
Yes, Scriabin wrote a little poem to set up the opening of that sonata. In a light mist, translucent vapour, lost afar and yet distant, a star gleams softly. It's beautiful, you hear it in the music.
Gorgeous.
We're going to hear César Franck next, a bit of movement on the stage behind us as the microphones are repositioned, because Jack Liebeck, one of our chamber music partners, is going to join Dmytro now to play the César Franck Violin Sonata, written in 1884 as a wedding present.
It was, and it was written for the amazing violinist Isaïe. And I think the first performance was actually at the wedding on a borrowed violin and a hotel piano.
And it was a sight reading, I think. I mean, as yes. I hadn't seen it, didn't know that he was going to be given this amazing gift as a wedding present, but they managed to do it. I think it was him and the bride's brother or something.
Absolutely. And then Isaïe became such a champion of this piece, and he always had played with con amore, you know, because it was written for a love story for a wedding. And
yeah,
what a gift to have for a wedding.
Absolutely. And that championing of the work by Isaïe over the decades really helped establish César Franck, didn't it?
It did, because he'd been overlooked for many, many years in his younger years, and people sort of put him in this organist bracket, I think. And so, you know, he really came into his own. He actually only wrote a small number of chamber pieces, but this is one of the great sonatas in the violin and piano repertoire.
And it has a famously tough piano part, doesn't it? Big demands made on the pianist.
It does, all the way through, because even in the slower movements, you know, one has to create incredible atmosphere. And the second movement is particularly ferocious. But, it's a major part, and not to be underestimated.
Well, pacing around backstage is our pianist this evening, Dmytro Chony. There's Jack Liebeck, one of the Leeds Piano Competition's accompanists this year. We heard him several times so far, but we're going to hear him now playing the violin part in the César Franck Violin Sonata with our penultimate semi-finalist, Dmytro Chony.
Thank you. The César Franck Violin Sonata, played by Dmytro Chony from Ukraine. The violinist Jack Liebeck.
What a wonderful sonata that is. I mean, just taking aside their performance, I feel that Dmytro has probably played quite a bit of chamber music in his time, but I think what the jury will be looking for is such a lyrical sonata in places, but to see what clarity is underneath. And also the piano part provides such a depth of harmony. So I think that's a very critical part of this sonata and one aspect they'll really be paying attention to.
Very interesting, isn't it, how much Schumann we're hearing in this competition. An awful lot between the pianists we've heard.
It's fascinating, isn't it? I don't think I've ever come across a competition where Schumann and also Clara seem to be right at the centre of it. And also, let's remember in the novelette that we just heard that Schumann actually pinched one of her tunes from the Notturno and put that... He thought she would be pleased. He thought she would like it.
I
think it was a very nice tribute. Yes. I'm sure she loved it.
Yes. So we've heard 9 of the 10 semi-finalists in this 2021 Leeds International Piano Competition. One left from Kazakhstan, Alim Besambayev, who I know has caused a lot of excitement among people reporting back on viewing this competition using our social media hashtag #LeedsPiano2021. And then what's going to happen is that the jury are going to go off and add up their votes. There'll be a bit of discussion then about the concertos that each of the 5 finalists will play with the Royal Liverpool Philharmonic Orchestra on Thursday and on Friday nights. And about an hour after we hear the last note of music, Kathy and I will be back on the Facebook pages, medici.tv and Leeds Piano Competition's Facebook pages, with Dame Imogen Cooper, chair of the jury, who will announce the names of the 5 finalists. I mean, this is going to be not a fun time for the jury, is it?
No, it's very, very difficult, because I think now this other element of chamber music is in, apart from the contemporary music, it's a big part of this semi-final. And I think it's been really fascinating to watch or to listen to how some of the competitors have responded to chamber music. Mm. So I think they'll have their work cut out in some ways to value that part, but also see the musician as a whole, their experience.
It makes it very difficult, doesn't it, if you've absolutely loved a pianist as a solo artist in the second round, and you love what they've done as a solo artist in the semis, but the chamber music hasn't gone so well for them. What do you then do as a...
I think you then kind of try to add up everything as a whole and take it into some considerations, perhaps. It just depends, you know, it depends a little bit what the difference was. Yeah. If there was a huge difference, they might think, OK, that's really not good enough. That showed that musician wasn't able to listen and was in their own sound world and just sort of on another planet. But if they think, okay, it wasn't maybe their best aspect, but it was still showed what a wonderful musician they were. And equally, when somebody goes through to the finals, you know, perhaps their concerto experience is also not as
high
as everything.
They might never have played with a professional orchestra.
Well,
it's not impossible.
That's what happened to me.
We'll talk more about that a bit later on. We're going to meet some of the other brilliant young pianists here at Leeds during the interval 2 of the Tabor Piano Ambassadors, who are here playing those fantastic pianos across the city. But let's first of all meet the global ambassador of the Leeds International Piano Competition, the one and only Lang Lang, performing at Carnegie Hall. Thank you.
Playing in pink at Carnegie Hall, Lang Lang. Really sorry that he's not with us for this Leeds Piano Competition. Travel plans for so many people have been made complicated by the events of the past 18 months, but I'm sure he will be back here in 3 years' time. He is the global ambassador of the Leeds Piano Competition. Two more ambassadors with me now, two of our Tabor Piano ambassadors. We welcome, first of all, Bernaya Hamey, and we welcome Mary Harewood. Welcome to both of you. Thanks very much indeed for joining us. Bernaya, tell us first of all where you are, what you're doing in life, what stage are you at in your piano career?
I'm studying at the Royal College of Music in London. So I've just finished my first year of undergraduate studies with Dina Parakina.
And Mary?
So I'm also with Bernaya at Royal College of Music, so we knew each other before.
So how did you end up here in Leeds?
So basically we got an email from our college and they said they put forward this scheme that Leeds were doing and they said that they'd like us to put us two forward. And obviously we were both delighted to be a part of it, so we auditioned and luckily we got the places.
So what does it mean to be a piano ambassador? What do you actually do?
Yes, it sounded like a huge opportunity when I got the email, and it's been amazing just being here, like meeting the competitors, living with them, and also getting out on the trail and promoting the piano and the competition.
And are you doing a lot of playing?
Quite a lot of playing, yes, and most of it outside to bring it to the public. Also some playing, we play to some school children as well, trying to inspire them to learn the piano, and yeah, it's been a really wonderful experience.
Well, look, we've got a bit of film of both of you playing, so let's have a look at that, and then we can find out more about what you've been up to. Mary, that is quite a piano. Yeah. Describe it to us. What was on top of it?
So I think it's been done by, it's a part of the sculpture scheme. So obviously that one's to do with, at the bottom of the piano, I don't know if you saw, it said like different dates and different years, started I think about 1850 to 2020. And sort of like the structure sort of, it frails out at the top. So it's sort of like to do with the environment and sort of to show how like our environment sort of like, unfortunately, like decreasing over time.
It's very interesting to bring that thought together, isn't it? We were talking about it earlier on.
Yes.
To bring the idea of global warming of the environment together with piano music.
Yeah, it's really interesting, and that's what I quite like about the projects as well, because it's not just purely about the piano as well. Yeah. You're bringing in other like important issues and important like concepts into it. It's really quite interesting.
And Bernaya, you had quite a crowd there.
Yeah, well, I think that was probably taken on the very first day that we were here, and we each played 30-minute slots around the city, and they were advertised, and it attracted quite a large crowd to each of our recitals, so it was lovely to see that people were really interested and really wanted to hear us play.
And in terms of the work you've done in schools with children, I mean, do you sense that what the Leeds is doing is just making people think about the piano, thinking about taking up an instrument?
Yeah, hopefully. That's what I hope's happening. Apparently, like, after we played for one of the school children, they all went back to the school and they're sort of pretending to play the piano on that log. So hopefully we're doing a good job at sort of spreading the message.
That's mission accomplished, isn't it? I mean, if you've achieved that, that really is something very special. You're a couple of years younger than the pianist. You're what? How old are you?
Both 19.
19. So the youngest pianist here is 20. We go up to 29. So maybe you've got a few years to go. I mean, a piano competition is going to be on your long-term plan. Do you think it's perhaps inevitable, is it?
Yeah, I think so. I think you do have to try a few. It's a good experience, and it's good to push your playing to the next level. So, yeah.
And if you do come to competition, do you feel you're now, Mary, going to be better prepared for it?
A lot better prepared. I feel like before, if I came into something like this, like I'd be very nervous, but like it's been such a good experience, like being able to see the insides and like what's going on inside and like just the general process in general. Yeah. So I feel like that it's been so helpful.
And everybody's been saying that this is such a friendly piano competition this year, that everybody is just open to get on, to have a good time. Yes, of course there's a competitive element to it, but actually people are just so delighted to be back together again. Is that something you've picked up? Is that true, or are we just saying that and actually everyone's out there fighting against each other?
No, it's definitely true. I mean, we've had some great times socialising with many of the competitors. They all seem to get on really well. A lot of them have also said how friendly the competition is, how well they've been looked after. So yeah, it's definitely true.
Good. Thank you both very much indeed for joining us this evening, and good luck with the rest of your work as Tabor Piano Ambassadors. Benaiah Hemi and Amiri Harewood, two of our ambassadors here in Leeds. Let's look back once again now into the history of the competition. We're going to go back to 1987. If you were with us for the last Leeds, you'll remember the pianist Noriko Agao was my guest for the concerto finals. Here she is on stage in the 1987 final. Nagawa playing Prokofiev at the 1987 Leeds International Piano Competition when she took third prize. Various people messaging us using the social media hashtag LeedsPiano2021 to say, fascinating seeing these old clips, red cummerbunds to the fore and really vivid coloured dresses. It's all a bit more toned down now, isn't it?
Yes, possibly. Yeah, the stars have changed. I don't think Sir Simon looks like that anymore with the red cummerbund.
Certainly not. You're great mates with Noriko Agarwal. I was saying that we had her as guest for the finals three years ago.
We've done a lot of two piano playing together. Not so much recently, but over the years we have. And I think that's one of the things to stress, that, you know, a lot of these pianists here today will actually make friendships that could last for a lifetime. And I have to say that playing two pianos is great fun.
I think also one of the things that Noriko achieved was to spread the word of the Leeds internationally. Mm. You know, the Leeds suddenly got a huge following in Japan after her appearance in the final, and more Japanese pianists came to the competition the following year. And that global nature of it is really what makes it such a vital and such an important piano competition, isn't it?
Absolutely. And actually, Noriko has gone on to work with competition. She's very much involved with the Hamamatsu competition in Japan. So, yes, that global spreading of the message is really important, and hopefully everybody will remember Leeds with some fondness.
Yeah. Well, if you're watching in Japan, welcome to our live exclusive note-by-note coverage of the 2021 Leeds Piano Competition here on medici.tv. You might be watching in Argentina or in Australia or in France or Belgium. Wherever you're tuned in, do think about making a donation to support the work of the Leeds in your local currency. You can press the button if you go to leedspiano.medici.tv. You'll find a button there to press help us to support our pianists. You can donate via PayPal or use a credit card. After all the chaos of COVID stealing away live audiences from young pianists, if you make a donation to the Leeds, you can help it continue its great work, supporting new generations of brilliant young keyboard stars, like Kathy Stott was when she took part in the Leeds.
Well, I'm still here, but actually, who's here? We've got a guest with us. And over the past few days, we've been talking a lot about the piano trail in Leeds. And welcome, Rosie Vora. You're an artist from Leeds.
Yeah.
Not originally, but you've been here for 10 years. Is that right?
Yeah.
And I really loved your installation with... Would you call it an installation?
I guess so. It felt like a sculpture, but I painted one of the pianos that's on the piano trail.
And tell us what it's called.
So my one is called The Elephant in the Room, but it's in response to Pianodrome sculpture.
That's it.
Yeah, mine is...
that's what I do.
Yeah. Mine's An Elephant Never Forgets, in response to The Elephant in the Room.
It is a fantastic... We're seeing it being played. It is just gorgeous.
So it's... That's my one.
Yes, wonderful. Look at that. But which came first? I mean, did you collaborate together to make this?
No, so each of the artists got paired with a sculpture that Pianodrome, the collective from Edinburgh, made. Right. So I was paired with the three huge tusks that are made out of piano parts. So I was given the brief to respond to that sculpture. So I took kind of parts of elephant skin and kind of treated the piano as if it was one big wraparound pattern of the elephant. And looked a lot into elephant cruelty and kind of different imagery from that research, and kind of painted that on the surface.
It's really heartening that these are works of art that work on so many different levels, because it's something that looks absolutely beautiful. There's a bit of a message attached to it as well, but it's also still a piano that can be played. And every time I've walked past it, I mean, I'm going past it most days, going from where we're staying in the centre of Leeds to come up here to the university, I seem to be people playing it.
Yeah.
I mean, it's enormously popular.
It's so wonderful, like, having made a piece of work that can be interacted with in that way, and just kind of wandering past and seeing people play it, anybody just... It's great. It's very joyous.
It's fantastic. Yeah. And I think we should actually just say that piano keys were, or just for people that don't know, the keyboard of a piano always had ivory keys. And thankfully, that's not necessary anymore. Well, not that it was ever necessary, but that was how it was. And so that is actually the link with the elephants, isn't it?
Yes, so it's kind of looking back at this history of the ivory trade. So the shapes in my painting, kind of the big tusk shapes, are taken from Kenya's largest ivory bonfire that they had in 2016, where they burnt all this confiscated ivory. And so it's kind of referencing lots of kind of sad history that's linked to the ivory trade.
We've been talking a bit over the past few days when we've been discussing the pianos and the works of art and the piano trail about. It's a bit sad they're going to kind of go the day after the competition, and there seems to be a bit of hope that one or two of them might survive a bit longer. Any news on yours?
We were just talking about that. She's very hopeful.
I think it is staying in the city, but it hasn't been confirmed which location, so I don't want to give it away. But I think 90% sure it's going to be staying.
Undercover or in the open air still?
Undercover, but in a very public space.
Brilliant. Fantastic
that
news.
Because, positive, doesn't it?
Yeah, I mean, to just see people carrying on playing these pianos beyond the competition would be a really, really fantastic
it
thing.
It would be great. Can you actually play, Rosie?
No, can't play. I did have lessons once, but I won't go there.
Well, you need to try Lawrence Owen's amazing app, which we were talking about at the beginning of the evening, and that could start you off.
Might set me on my journey.
You could play as well as Ulrich Gerhardt is playing right now as we get one or maybe two notes out of him as he tunes the piano. Rosie Vora,
thank you very much indeed for joining us.
And yes, Ulrich. Getting busy, a little bit of work to do after each pianist. I mean, he's such a perfectionist, Ulrich, isn't he?
He is, and I can tell from the way he's tuning now, he's spending an awful lot of time. I think the weather has changed considerably today, and so the atmosphere in this hall has changed, and everything like that affects the piano. Mm. So he's spending a little bit longer on it, I feel, than normal. But there's quite a beefy programme coming up.
Yeah.
So he's making sure it's going to sit up there for Aline.
And non-pianists might not realise that. I mean, the sensitivity of a piano to changes in climate. You know, we started off here last week and it was quite sultry in Leeds. It hit sort of 27 degrees one day. Then we had pouring rain. Mm. It was really quite chilly yesterday, but it was much milder again today. I mean, that's never good for a piano, is it?
No, absolutely. I mean, you know, the ideal is that it's at a constant temperature, but pianos, at the same time, they are moved around all over. I mean, this will be a piano that will find itself transported to many places in the UK. So they have to be fairly robust, but of course they are used for rehearsing from morning till night here.
Well, yeah, and as Ulrich pointed out to us earlier on, I mean, the amount of use of this piano in this week of Leeds is kind of about 6 months.
Absolutely. Everything in 6 days, so it's a lot. But we're very lucky to have him, I think, you know, and his dedication, and not only to the piano, but I've noticed the way he talks to the pianists. He's checking that they're happy, and he's part of the kind of support team, if you will, of the competitors.
Yeah, and this piano was used here at Leeds 3 years ago. He told me the other night this is probably its last Leeds appearance, but certainly not the end of its life. I imagine it'd be rather in demand as the Leeds piano. Everyone's
well, it won't go into retirement, but you know, it's just a particular type that you need for this.
Well, hopefully, Ulrich is getting near the end of his work on it, because we're expecting Aline Baysambayev to be on stage very, very shortly. 23-year-old pianist from Kazakhstan who's going to perform Ligeti Etudes, two of the Miroir by Ravel, Prokofiev as well, and his chamber music with three members of the Castalian Quartet. We're going to hear the Brahms Piano Quartet number 3 in C minor. Let's just remind ourselves of his appearance in round 2. Here is Alim Baysambayev, and he is playing from round 2, Beethoven. Alim Baysambeyev from Kazakhstan, playing part of Beethoven's final piano sonata, number 32. Obviously, Cathy, a lot of work to be done on the piano because Ulrich Gerhardt has had the whole interval and he's only just now finishing, putting away his glasses.
Absolutely, and everything done very methodically and carefully. And I think the one thing with Ulrich is he will not be rushed.
Well, I really like that.
Yeah, it's great. He wants it to be good.
Yeah, yesterday, and he said, look, I don't care if I keep you waiting 10 minutes. The piano has to be in an absolutely perfect state. And if it's not, he's not gonna apply his name to it. He's not gonna sign it off.
Well, I think it's fair enough. And you know, each competitor just has this one moment in each round wherever they're placed. This is their moment. They want that piano to be in tip-top shape. So it's quite right that he takes such a lot of trouble with it.
Just a reminder, we're about to see our last pianist in the semi-final of this 2021 Leeds International Piano Competition. They will play for 75 minutes. The jury will then go off and add up their votes. There'll be discussions about what repertoire the finalists will play. The five who go through to the finals will be live on medici.tv and the Leeds Piano Competition Facebook page about an hour after the last note of music, so about 10:45, to bring you live the names of tonight's finalists. Let's just have a look backstage. There is Alim Baysambeyev, who is going to play, as I say, two of Ravel's Miroir in his programme, Oiseau Triste and Unbach sur l'Océan. He's going to start with three of the etudes by Ligeti, finishing with that wonderful Devil's Staircase that we heard the other day. Alim Baysambeyev from Kazakhstan.
Thank you.
Bassem Beyev, 23 years old from Kazakhstan, playing Prokofiev's Piano Sonata number 7 in B flat. Before that, we heard two of Ravel's Miroir, Was It Peace, and songs and Sad Birds, and In Bachsur Nosia. And we started with three of the Etudes of Liberty.
Very enthusiastic response here in the hall, and what was fascinating, that terrific recital, but just everybody just stopped and listened, and you could really kind of you could feel the atmosphere in the hall from the very first notes that he played, and that just increased as time went on. So, marvellous recital from Ali there.
Yeah, and really well thought through. I mean, the way he kept the silence after The Devil's Staircase, yeah. The last of the Ligeti, absolutely held us, the audience, in the palm of his hand before going straight into Was It Triste by Ravel. I mean, that was music as theatre.
It certainly was, and he absolutely had the confidence to do it. I mean, you sometimes have these thoughts, but actually, when it comes to it, they have to feel organic and they have to feel right, not just a way. But he does have a command of the audience, and this is something it's a kind of inner confidence, but he's using the room. He's using that audience collective listening to his advantage.
Bit of reorganisation on stage, ready for the chamber music. Let's just talk, before we talk about Brahms, about Prokofiev 7, one of the war sonatas,
yes,
as they were called, by Prokofiev, premiered by Sviatoslav Richter in Moscow in 1943, sometimes nicknamed Stalingrad Sonata. And a thought that Prokofiev was pouring out, particularly in that finale, his rage at all that Stalin had done against fellow musicians.
Absolutely, and you feel it even from, that whole story starts back in the first movement, where there's that incredible restless feeling, and then the second movement, where it seems as if everything's okay, but you know very well it's not. Mm. So it's a sort of double-edged sword, and then when you get to that toccata, it's about controlling it, and just that build that actually I was talking about earlier, just having that reserve to really go that extra mile at the end.
So into a very different sound world next, with Brahms writing for piano quartet.
Well, this is totally different, and actually, but Brahms was in such a terrible place when he wrote this. It's another quintet that was revisited, but actually I think it was 13 years since he first composed it, and he actually took it down a semitone. He took it down in pitch to make it darker. And of course, Clara, again, she's appeared in so many works in this, as a central inspiration figure. So he was feeling pretty grim.
And he wanted to have it published with the image of a man and a gun on the front to reflect the idea of suicide in a sort of romantic sense.
Exactly, with a gun to his head, I think. And he struggled to get it published and only succeeded the second time by saying that it was easy to play.
Yes, Ilim Bayasembeyev waiting backstage there with three members of the Castalian Quartet, who have done such fine service as chamber music partners. They've had a very busy few days here in Leeds.
They certainly have, but I think they'll be glad now to play the Brahms, and they've had a good run with the Dvorak Quintet, so something new for them now.
So this is going to be the last piece of music we hear in the semi-finals of the 2021 Leeds International Piano Competition.
Ilim Bayasembeyev returns to the stage. Thank you. Altenbeyer playing the Brahms Piano Quartet number 3 in C minor with members of the Castalian String Quartet.
Absolutely wonderful chamber music playing there. It just felt actually, you know, that Aline had been playing with them many, many times before. You can hear rapturous applause in the background. And, you know, they've all had a short period of time to get these pieces together. Perhaps two rehearsals of 90 minutes each, something like that. But nobody was aware of anything. It just felt totally natural. And his balance with the string players was really spot on, really wonderful.
So with that, we've seen all 10 of the semi-finalists in this 2021 Leeds International Piano Competition. Sinny Simonon playing violin there, Charlotte Bonneton, the viola player. And there's Christopher Graves, cellist in the Castalian Quartet. And I think it's a good moment, Cathy, to give all our chamber music collaborators a big shout. Jack Liebeck, we heard earlier on this evening, and Laura van der Heijden, who we heard this afternoon, along with the Castalian Quartet. They have done such sterling work here at the Leeds, as you were just saying, working with these musicians, these finalists, who perhaps are really focused on playing solo, because that's the lion's share of what they do in the first stages of this competition, being forced to play chamber music, and being forced to prepare it in a matter of hours.
Absolutely, and also let's not forget that they've had to prepare two programmes, so they had another chamber work and a whole other solo programme as well. So when it had reached this whole stage, there was a lot going on just leading up to this. But yeah, fantastic to have those collaborators, because it's not an easy task. You know, some people will have come in with a lot of experience, and some may be, you know, quite fresh to it. And they have to navigate that without sort of leading them, but let them shine at the same time. Yeah. So, it's been fascinating.
Well, they had to bring two programmes for this semi-final. They also have to have brought with them two concertos. And the jury are going to now decide, once they've worked out the five pianists who will go through to Friday and Saturday's finals, they'll then have to think about which concerto they're going to play. And I guess that'll be based on a whole variety of things. I mean, we don't want two programmes that have got the same concerto four times. There'll be practicalities in terms of working with the orchestra, rehearsing, etc. And also perhaps they'll want to hear the broadest possible range of repertoire from each of the artists, considering what they've heard in the semis. They might perhaps balance the concerto against that?
It could well be. I mean, I'm think that will be a big consideration. If they've heard somebody playing a lot of big romantic music, they might say we want prefer to hear something a little bit more classical, and vice versa, and at the same time make a kind of cohesive program. I think that's also why there are five concertos. In the old days there used to be six, used to be three on each night. But yeah, they have quite a lot to deliberate right now. Some things maybe very clear. There's always a sort of... But let's remember that the jury are not allowed to discuss.
Which is going to be very, very difficult. You can imagine them in that room. It's pretty much below where we're standing now, totting up numbers, but not allowed to even kind of do anything by looking at each other.
Absolutely.
That might share information.
No, they're very, very strict about this, and we've been around them quite a lot, and there's just no talk about it. They're allowed to talk about people that have gone, but, you know, sometimes a result could just depend on one mark that goes either way. And
that's going to be the heartbreaking thing. It'll probably be quite easy to place 1, 2, 3 for the finalists. It's the fourth and fifth choices.
Yeah, possibly.
It could be incredibly close between 4, 5, 6, 7.
Yeah, exactly. And on another day, that could go in a different direction. Yeah. But this is the nature of it. And some competitions, you know, you go into a jury room and there's a great discussion, and some people are very passionate about, you know, promoting certain artists. And here, they just are totally against it.
Yeah, and people will say, why can't you have a discussion? Why can't there be kind of consideration and a bit of a kind of argument over which ones to go through? And there is a case for that. But then there's also the suggestion that if you do that the loudest voices prevail, the dominant people on the jury prevail, and that's not good either, is it?
Oh, it's certainly not good, and I think there's been a lot of that in the past. I mean, in various competitions around the world. And in the older times when there used to be more teachers with their students in, there was really a lot of that going on. So here, nobody's allowed to have a student. I think if somebody has played to you, kind of in passing, maybe that doesn't count.
But not a formal relationship.
No, not absolutely not at all. Not at all.
Well, look, we're reckoning on about an hour before we get the name of those names of those five finalists and the repertoire they're going to perform. So, take a break. Maybe go and catch up with stuff you've missed. Perhaps catch up with one or two of the pianists that you've seen this evening taking part in round two. It's all available on demand here on medici.tv. We're then going to be live on Facebook, on the medici.tv Facebook page and the Leeds Piano Competition Facebook page, with a ceremony with the results, which will be announced by Imogen Cooper, the news of the five finalists, we reckon in about an hour's time from now.
But before that, there's time to make a donation. Yes. Don't you think this is the perfect time to show your appreciation for what, you know, we've been so privileged to hear these wonderful musicians, and from wherever you're listening, any currency is accepted. Any amount from one pound to $1 million, anything in between, would be gratefully received. These young musicians really need our support. So find that button, find the link onto the page and donate if you can.
I can still hear there are lots of people downstairs. They're clearing the stage here. We won't hear this beautiful piano in competition in this hall again in this 2021
right.
Leeds Piano Competition, but I think you can probably hear the buzz of audience members who are staying. And as happened when we reached the end of the second round on Friday night of last week, I suspect we're going to have quite a few people who are going to stay late into the night here in Leeds. It's going to be 11 o'clock at Leeds time before we get the results. I think there are going to be a lot of people staying around here in the hall to hear that.
I'm sure they won't want to miss it.
No, I certainly don't. It's going to be very, very exciting. I hope you'll stay with us as well. Join us on Facebook, on the medici.tv page or the Leeds Piano page. Maybe get there in 45 minutes from now. They might get a bit faster. We've got a few things to talk about before we actually get to the results. Keep an eye on it on your computer. Have your phone on in the corner so you don't miss it. We'll see you in an hour or so with the very exciting news. It'll be very sad news for five pianists, thrilling news for five pianists, but we'll tell you a bit later on who's got through to the final of this year's Leeds International Piano Competition. For now, from Kathy and me, revelling in all the glorious music we've heard today.
Fabulous. What a treat.
Yeah. Bye for now from Leeds.